We start off with the markets. The S&P closing at a new all-time high, the Dow jumping more than 115 points, the Nasdaq and tech up more than 1%. We've seen this story before, the S&P 500 peaking its head above the highs and then failing to launch. So with tariffs off the table for now, is the next leg of the rally all about the Fed? Steve Ross.
I think it has been all about the Fed. So I don't even think tariffs were maybe 20% of the story. I think for me, it's about the Fed. The Fed is still in the back pocket of the market. They have that. And the tariff story can only get better from here. So, yes, it's about the Fed. It's about higher markets from here going forward.
Why can the tariff story only get better from here? That's what I don't get.
Because we've already, I think that we've factored in the negativity on the tariff headlines. We've already seen those at worst, right? Uh-huh. Or you don't agree with that. So,
well,
I do.
Tell you what. So, I think you're right in terms of headlines. Markets digested months and months, years of headlines. What we don't have are CEOs and the real impact. And when you throw the trade war into a world where leading economic indicators have been basically moving lower for the last 18 months, not just the last few months. So you can make an argument that this trade war has done things to CEOs and to the businesses and to earnings that we still haven't seen yet. But I, in terms of a market event, mm-hmm. I can agree with what Steve said. And in fact, where are we? We're at May 3rd, which was the last time we basically got some good news out of trade we're at all-time highs, right before President Trump started to tweet. So what we have is a little bit more Fed in this environment. But again, if you look at how bonds reacted today, bonds didn't tell you it's off to the races. The German Bund went to fresh all-time lows, minus 36 bips before rallying a bit. ISM in the U.S., you name it, the macro data points were not good.
Yeah. Mark, we also get a lot of earnings before the next Fed meeting, which could be a key determinant.
Yeah, and I think, unfortunately, I think this is the earnings season where you're going to start to hear some of that come out on the conference calls, that the CEOs are a bit concerned, that they might not have the confidence that they need to execute on their growth plans. And my concern is if we look out to like the fourth quarter earnings estimates, I mean, we're looking at like double digit year over year growth. And I don't think that's going to happen. Those are still way too high. They're going to have to come down. As they come down, the issue is it's going to exert downward pressure on stocks, and that's going to offset a lot of the positives that we're getting from trade and the Fed.
Well, yeah, and so it just depends whether you deem it to be a positive. I don't think anything really happened. There was no there. It was a calculated situation that happened, not too different that we saw at the end of November into the G20 meeting, and then declaring some sort of victory. And I just think it's really important that every time the S&P has been above 2900 over the last year or so, it's had a flush lower and sentiment gets really bullish. Now, the more likely it is to stay up here, fine, then you may have a breakout. You may establish a new range, but I think all this other stuff is really important. You know, if the most important thing to you is the Fed, then you better think about why they have made this really historic pivot in such a short period of time to dovishness. And when you see the sort of data that we saw about global PMIs, that should make you nervous if they start cutting into weaker data.
Right.
That to me is the thing that makes the S&P 500 playing for a breakout at 2950 very dangerous.
Right. So for me, I think ultimately I do believe it's a negative for the Fed to start cutting now, because I don't think they can combat anything. But the market has to adjust to the Fed cutting now. And so they go to the most accommodative spot, which is the equity market, which is a risk-on play. So I don't believe they have enough ammo. And that's why Powell is saying, I'm dovish, but I might cut. I'm dovish, but I might cut.
So July might not happen in your view.
July might not happen. And I think the best thing he could do is not let it happen, because the markets would sell off.
That would be a disaster.
Yeah.
The markets could sell off. But I would think that you still have to worry about, what happens when he does cut? What happens when he does hit the 50 basis points?
But the market's basically saying 75 basis points between now and year end. Yeah. They're basically saying 100% in July. That to me would be a major offside.
But we did hear. Bullard, and we did hear from Powell last week where they're stepping off the gas a little bit on easy money, and it was more of two cuts versus three cuts. So the market has to adjust to that.
Steve, do you think the market goes higher in that environment when those headlines hit the tape?
No. I think knee-jerk reaction is for the market to sell off if the Fed does not cut. But I also believe that this is keeping the short sellers at bay, because you know that cut is coming. You just don't know when it's coming. It's playing Russian roulette with the short sellers. So who steps in front of this train right now and shorts the market?
I don't know. Maybe Dan.
Has it been successful lately?
You think there's going to be a flush?
I think there's a very good likelihood over the course of this summer. I mean, think about where we are when we have this sort of rhetoric. I think one thing the president has really proven that he is a very bad negotiator with a good hand versus the Chinese, who have a bad hand and are doing a very good job in negotiating.
Why is the market up at all-time
highs,
though?
Steve, I'm just saying, it is what it is. When you have, you know, senators from his own party thrashing him on giving away stuff that you don't need to give away just to get out of a G20 meeting. Yeah, the Huawei thing. And it goes back to ZTE last year. These are really important parts. It's not about a bilateral trade agreement. It's not about selling chips to the Chinese and then buying back the equipment and plugging it into our infrastructure.
But if we're making it, and I'm not being combative with you. I'm just saying, yeah, if the market should not be at all-time highs,
be combative with them.
Why not?
The market should not
split them up.
So the market should not be at all-time highs. I'm looking face forward,
waiting for the split.
So the market should not be at all-time highs if he was doing such a terrible job at negotiating. So everyone said that the Chinese had an unlimited time horizon. That goes out the window. The markets are up. They're all-time highs.
The Chinese just got some massive concessions here. They got some massive concessions that our chip guys can start selling back to Huawei.
What do they have to do in return?
Nothing.
An unspecified amount of farm products.
So the market should have sold off.
So, folks, let's get to stocks, because ultimately it doesn't sound like anybody's terribly constructive on cyclicality here. So what's going to work? What's going to work is what's been working.
Tech?
I tell you what's going to outperform tech, I continue to think, are going to be either consumer discretionary names that are, you know, big cash flow generating businesses that can be somewhat defensive in this environment. We've gone through fast food at nauseam. We've gone through things like Starbucks, Coca-Cola. I think they're going to continue to work. If you think about that, which has had an asymmetric or underperformed response to the month of June, which was 9% down and basically 9% up, look at Japan. Look at other parts of the world where, and I know we're going to have this chat, so I'll leave that one alone, but the exporting countries of the world, if you believe that there's just some short-term relief, should outperform, and even Apple. Again, you can say this is a company-specific underperformance, but most people tied this stock to the trade war, and if we're back where we were on May 3rd, I think Apple should be there too.
Yeah.
So dating back to September 30th of last year, I mean, this has definitely been a defensive rotation, right? So money's come out of cyclicals, it's moved into defensives, and I think as we start to make more and more progress on the trade deal, we see a Fed cut or two, I think you're going to see that rotation reverse course, and I think you're going to see money start to flow out of defensives into cyclicals, and there could be a good opportunity there. It's not here right now today, but I think it's coming.
So which specific ones?
So the tech sector in particular. Okay. I mean, the highest percentage, they have the highest exposure to revenues from China right now, so I think that's the way to play
it. I would go cyclical. I would go with the chemical plays that have been beaten up, like a WestRock. I would stick with Lennar that was beaten up last week, KB Homes that reported better after Lennar got its head taken off. So I would stick with a lot of those plays that don't seem intuitive to the overall market, but I would go back to cyclical plays.
Yeah, and I'll just make one point about some tech spending or some earnings that we've seen over the last month. We saw Salesforce, we saw Oracle, and what they're telling us is that in those spaces, they're not seeing a hit to enterprise spending right now. So those are some areas that look, I think, you know, generally insulated right now.
Even despite the valuation.
Well, yeah, and we, you know, on Friday on OA, you were not here, Mel, but we were talking about Microsoft, you know, trading at about 27 times trailing, 2.5 PE to growth. These stocks are getting really expensive here, too. And, you know, you guys talk about Apple all the time. I can't remember the last time Apple had a forward multiple in the high teens.
It deserves it.
Okay, but we will look back at some point when the S&P is much lower and say, oh, you know what, we should have been crowding in trillion-dollar market cap names that were trading
at
multiple that were really, really stretched.
Well, okay, so there's a lot of things that were implied in your statement. Yeah. They're not even implied, they're stated. You're saying when the S&P is a lot lower, Apple's going to look like a bad trade. To me, it's a defensive company that I would put in line with those other companies I was talking about. So again,
significant McDonald's.
Significant capital markets opportunity, a lot of cash. They can basically have it put underneath the stock, but the transition is underway. I think the bad headlines in terms of their handset business
Services, 40 billion. Maybe they're underappreciated on the market.
Can I just explain one thing? I kind of disagree on that whole thesis, okay? Because if our consumer is keeping the entire global economy at float, all those names that you just mentioned, if we do go into recession, if we do have risk assets come in, are going to get hit much harder than some of these enterprise companies that have a massive secular, well, Apple for one.
Okay,
I mean, we've already seen that. They're not growing their handsets. So if their installed base is not growing at some point and they have blockages of certain geographies where they can't be, aka China, okay, then you have an issue right? You have an issue with growth. That's just 100%.
We can agree to disagree on Apple. Are you also saying that the other big companies that have outperformed, like a Coca-Cola,
Starbucks,
like a Pepsi, like a Starbucks,
yeah,
like a
I think Coca-Cola is ridiculous. A sugar water company trading at 25 times. I mean, it makes absolutely no sense.
Okay, but look at other times. We've had plenty of opportunities in the last 5 or 6 years where people thought we were actually getting into a recession, and it was time to be running into defensive names, and these names outperform every time.
Dude, I mean, look at every one of those stocks that you just mentioned have had peak to trough declines that doubled the worst decline that the S&P has had in the last few years. I mean, Apple sold off 40%. Starbucks sold off 40%.
Apple?
No, what I'm saying is all those consumer names actually get hit much harder when things get nasty in the broad market.